I'll begin with factors which should not be very important, but students give a lot of undue importance to them. I would like to call them tiebreaker factors, right? These are factors which you should use only when you have two or three B schools, roughly of the equal grades that you have selected, and you have to decide which of them should you choose. They should not be a reason why you should apply or not apply to B school at this particular stage. First factor, which should not be as important as they are made out to be, are your placement figures, right? Placement figures are basically like Pamela Anderson's boobs, right? They are fantastic, but you know that they are fake and there is a lot of padding which is going on over there. Almost every college inflates its placement reports, especially if it is a placement report given just around the time that the admissions are actually going on. You can very clearly discount the numbers given by at least 10 to 25%. Another common myth is that every college has 100% placement. While colleges do have close to 100% placement, very few colleges actually achieve 100% placement. If you are in the bottom 5% of your college at the time of placement, it is very difficult for you to actually get placed. A lot of placements become 100% placements because the placement committee will give you what is called an opt-out form. Basically, in this opt-out form, they will tell you, please sign this form and say that I am going to explore opportunities on my own, or I'm going to join my own business, or I'm going to create a new startup, or I'm going to take a break from placement. I don't want the college placement assistance. So that way, they exclude you out of the placement calculations altogether. Now, if you are in the bottom 5%, it is going to be difficult for the college to place you. A company, especially a large company or a company which has some amount of bargaining power, is going to hire from a slightly lower rank college, and they will probably get a topper and a more hardworking person than you who are in the bottom 5% of the very top college, right? So just because you get into a top college doesn't mean that your work is done. Your work is actually going to begin even from now, this point onwards. You are going to have to prove your worth again and again consistently. Now, one source of reasonably authentic placement information is basically the mandatory disclosure, which is put up by colleges on their website. Now, AICT requires all AICT approved colleges to basically put up the mandatory disclosure. Unfortunately, the colleges play a little fast and loose with the rules. While you're required to put up the mandatory disclosure, the latest mandatory disclosure or the latest placement figures are usually not put up, at least most of the time at the time of the admission, right? They usually put it up a little later, right? So you may not get the freshest mandatory disclosure data, right? It might be a year old or sometimes even 2 years old data, and they just completely forget to update it, right? Now, there are a lot of colleges which also use private rating agencies like CRISIL, etc., to audit their placement figures. While this gives us some amount of assurance that the placement figures are reasonably good, the placement figures which are usually given to them are what is presented to by the college. Now, IIM Ahmedabad a few years ago started its own placement reporting standards process. It's available on its website. It's a very, very, very elaborate method of showing those ratings, looking at what are the type of roles which the people got, everything, etc. Unfortunately, except for IIM Ahmedabad, very few colleges actually use the placement reporting standards. It was thought that it would become the reporting standard for all colleges. Unfortunately, it has not picked up as much as it was expected to. Now, besides the placements, there is one other factor which usually goes almost hand in hand with placements, which is basically the ROI factor. ROI is basically return on investment. It's calculated as average placement figures got by the batch over the fees charged by the college. Now, while this is very simple to calculate, it is also a little stupid sometimes to use it blindly, right? There are colleges where the denominator, which is basically the fees, is extremely low. Right, so by this measure, you would see that colleges like FMS Delhi and JBIMS will have a huge ROI factor. While fees is a reasonably important factor, it also leads to a lot of crazy and fake Quora profiles and Quora threads like this, which asks you basically why did XYZ choose FMS over an IIMA or an IIMB and an IIMC. Some of the answers are hilarious. I have also written one answer over there. You can actually go and look at that answer. Now, by and large, most of the colleges are very competitively priced. So if you look at the fees at IIMA, IIMB, IIMC, that will be roughly the same. If you look at the fees at the top private colleges in the country, they are going to be roughly the same. Obviously, there will be some variations on the basis of location. For example, colleges in Bombay will be slightly higher priced than colleges in other parts of the country because real estate in Bombay is costly and manpower is going to be costly because living in Bombay itself is costly. But by and large, they are very, very reasonably priced in terms of fair market price. If you're looking at a top 40 or a top 50 B school in the country, you're looking at, except for these few exceptions, you're looking at a rough tuition fees of somewhere about 15 to 20 lakhs, and your overall cost is going to be anywhere between 20 to 25, 26 lakhs for a two-year MBA program. If you're going to say that 25 lakhs is a huge investment for me and I cannot afford it, now think of it like this. Usually the starting salaries, especially for people who are roughly about 2 to 3 years of experience, can actually double and in a lot of cases triple also once they graduate out of the MBA program. So the jump that you're going to get with an MBA program is going to be much, much higher than what you're going to get if you are going to be in the same position for 2, 2.5, 3 years down the line. Usually you look at an ROI over a 5 to 7 year horizon. Most people are able to pay off their B school loans within 2 to 3 years out of graduating from colleges. Now, speaking of salaries, one way of actually going and figuring out whether the placement statistics and these ROI factors, etc., are actually true is LinkedIn, right? You can actually go and look at the LinkedIn profile of the batch which graduated a year ago or 2 years ago and see what are the type of profiles they are actually getting. While not everyone is going to be completely honest about it, most people are more honest on LinkedIn than they are going to be on Facebook or individual college forums. Most college loyalties also die out once you graduate out of college. They look nice only in college reunions or when you're trying to get a job through the college network or getting a funding or getting somebody's contact through the college network as such. It matters when you go down the rung of B schools. When you go at the level of say 60 or 70 or 80, most B schools over there are anyways located in metros.